Welcome to OCD, Obsessive Consumer Disorder. A show that explores the myriad lives of partners, promoters, and professionals in the media, advertising, creative, art, events, and entertainment space. We are here to find out what makes our hearts tick and why we continue to pursue what we think is a promising career. Possibly even solve some of the common problems we have together. I am Gautam Reddy, host of your show today, and today I have with me Charan Lakkaraju, promoter and founder of stuMagz, a student community platform which has more than 3.5 lakh students across the country today, connecting brands to student purposes. Charan, I want to know a little bit more about you and where you were raised and how you found your purpose through the course of your formative years, you know, and where you were at different points in time, what influences, etc. So if you could just talk us through that a little bit, might set context for all of us.
First of all, thank you, Gautam, for inviting.
It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. Looking forward to the conversation.
Yeah. A born Hyderabadi, completely born and raised in Hyderabad itself. Any Hyderabadi, the regular cricket, biryanis, and that's how the whole childhood was. Yeah. But the whole advantage of our generation, when I can say our generation, we are a sandwich generation.
Yeah.
We are neither generation X, neither generation Z.
Yeah.
We are the generation Y, and we always asked why for every work.
Yeah.
And we questioned the status quo.
Yeah. Not that we got any answers, but we kept asking.
We keep questioning the thing. That's the reason we always, I always call we are generation Y.
Yeah.
Engineer by chance, not by choice.
Yeah.
When you, these days,
Life starts after engineering.
Life starts after engineering.
Options and choices are only given after.
There was a very funny statement recently I was telling to one of my friends. In India, people start doing anything what they love after engineering.
Yeah. Very true.
And unfortunately, I got good score in mathematics in my 10th standard. Mm. It meant that I have to do engineering.
It's understood.
So then engineering happened, but the family, my uncle was into advertising.
Right.
So that had that culture in the family of, you know, at entrepreneurship, home, yeah. And you keep listening to such words, yeah. Jargon,
yeah.
Sometimes discussion at the dining table,
yeah.
You know, where you just understand the importance of a brand,
yeah.
And all these jargons.
Funny enough, most of my understanding of this space happened at the dining table.
Yeah,
I come from a typical background.
And it happens in a very natural way.
Yeah.
And it's not like, okay, fine, someone asks you a question.
Yeah.
But when you just keep listening to different case studies and you give those funny opinions,
yeah.
At 7th and 8th class, but you consider them in a very crazy way. Right. These days, I feel whenever I listen to my nephews or nieces, it takes me back to those days.
Yeah.
Where you don't even think...
There is no restriction on thought.
Especially
you can be as open as you want, as free as you want.
Right. The moment you enter into the profession, you become more pragmatic.
True.
This doesn't work, this works.
You start walking the line. You entered because you didn't want to walk the
Correct.
Line, but you end up walking the line.
Correct. So that's how we grew up in the city of Hyderabad itself.
Yeah.
And the whole idea of getting into entrepreneurship, yeah. Or understanding Gen Z,
yeah.
Started with one question when I entered one of the villages yeah. Outside Hyderabad called Kompally.
Yeah.
So there was a funny discussion which was happening between me and my friend from an IIT.
Mm.
He was telling that there are lots of colleges here.
Mm.
Then I said, yes, there are. Then the demography there
mm.
was the number of students in one village outside Hyderabad
mm.
is equal to the number of students in all IITs put together in India.
Mm-hmm.
So then there was a very funny quote. He said, India has 50% plus population under 25.
Mm.
And this under 25 population is not tapped.
Right.
In a right sense.
Yeah.
And everyone looks at students as customers yeah. or consumers yeah. or influencers.
Yeah.
So either they fit into any one category there.
Yeah.
So, but no one is trying to concentrate exclusively on that segment.
Yeah.
Was the first kind of a, you know, dimag ki batti jala de types
okay.
thought
okay.
In the year 2014. That's when I started thinking about what to do with this segment.
Right, right. And how did your passion for public speaking and come through, and your passion for cricket? So what are your influences that led to you, you know, sort of towards entrepreneurship?
So public speaking is something which I enjoyed from my childhood.
Yeah.
Because when you were a head boy in a school, and I studied in the other part of the Hyderabad,
right.
Which is the Eastern Hyderabad.
Right.
So where when you just speak, you become a leader.
Yeah.
Sometimes in the school, it's
There's
all about
barely any people even opening their
absolutely.
Mouth or like voicing their opinions.
Correct. And the moment you voice out your opinions, even you're feeble and you're not strong physically.
Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. And it all boils down to how you express your opinion.
Correct.
And cricket is one thing which keeps us, you know, into the groove and the whole team spirit.
Yeah.
And the hunger for success.
Understanding winning and losing is part of the game.
And patience. And again, anytime you can come back into the match. In a cricket, the same applies to life too.
Correct.
There are crests and troughs.
Yeah.
So these two things got in from the school, you know, it's all about the school.
So they sort of contributed to your whole
Correct.
Entrepreneurial sort of a make.
The word entrepreneur itself, which we didn't hear it when we were growing up.
Yeah.
Even the startup word didn't exist such.
Pretty much.
In our dictionaries as such. But it was all the way, it's all about, there is one word which keeps talking or ringing in our minds was to be independent.
Yeah.
And the whole independence today is defined by entrepreneurship or startups.
Correct. Correct.
So unfortunately, once you get into business, you know that you're not the boss. Everyone else is a boss.
Yeah. Yeah. So I think you've done like a small stint at Infosys before you built your platform, right?
Right.
And what was that stint about? Why did you jump out of it? How long was it?
Correct. So very nice point because that a lot of people think that I was like jumped into an entrepreneurship from day one. It was not the case. When I graduated from engineering, the first thought I had on my mind, it was 2009.
Yeah.
And the year was a recession year.
Right.
Where
global recession had just started.
Just started out and the whole Lehman Brothers.
Yeah, yeah.
Was planning to go abroad.
Yeah.
Any typical South Indian dream of traveling to United States was lingering in my mind.
Yeah.
But again, I just got this offer because that was the only company which was not asking technical questions.
Right.
So that was the only reason.
That's where you found some comfort.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the moment you get a job in a company like Infosys, you are the blue-eyed boy in the whole family.
Correct.
And 2009, then I just thought, let's work in Infosys. At least get those 3 years work ex so that I can get into masters at ISB or something like that.
Yeah.
So, but once I reached that third, and Infosys and ISB were neighbors in Hyderabad.
Yeah, they're right across the street from each other.
Right across the street. So when you keep interacting, as you asked initially about the public speaking, that made me join Toastmasters in Infosys.
Sure.
Toastmasters is an international public speaking platform.
Right.
And that helped us to get connected to students of ISB too.
Right.
So Infosys was a straight choice because it had a lot of extracurricular activities. We had a cricket team.
Yeah.
We had public speaking apart from the regular software work.
Yeah.
So that was one reason I have chosen Infosys.
Right.
Secondly, it helped me to interact with different diverse set of culture of people.
Right.
And I always feel once you work in an organization, you always start respecting when you start an organization.
Correct. Correct.
And it teaches you in a different
way. The value of seeing an organization operating at scale.
Correct.
And what you need to do, because when you start out, you don't think of anything but the environment around you.
Right.
But eventually you know that at some point it's going to get to that scale.
And I always feel culture is something which
that
you
drives,
need to learn.
Yeah.
And culture is always defined by a leader.
Correct.
Yeah. And most of the organizations today you see, the company's culture is great. It depends on the leader of the organization.
Correct. Correct.
So and that you learn when you work with someone or under someone or in an organization. So that's where it taught me lots of things. And the other thing, when you work in a global organization, you learn lots of hierarchical patterns. So, you know what?
Which could be both good and bad,
The pros
and
the cons of it.
Yeah, yeah.
And sometimes the decision making or the rigidity.
Correct.
Tomorrow when you start an organization, how you want it to be flexible.
Correct.
How you can create more flexibility in creating more partnerships.
Correct.
It doesn't happen at a certain level.
How you can break levels of authority.
Correct.
How you can, all of these.
All of these are minor things which are not taught at classroom level, but you can learn it at real time.
Yeah. So that experience really sort of helped you succeed at what you did in the next avatar of your life.
Yes.
Of your profession.
And the kind of work which I did there for Infosys Campus Connect, the kind of voluntary thing which I used to go to colleges,
sure.
And there was a fresh time hiring which was happening.
Sure.
So when I visited colleges officially as an Infosys member,
right,
the kind of respect you get is different.
Right.
And you start making your own network.
Correct.
And you start interacting with students.
Correct.
So that helped me to understand the different cultures. And it made me good friends with different people from different parts of India, yeah, which is helping in business too.
Correct.
Yeah.
What was the initial idea behind stuMagz? And for the people watching the show, listening to the show, what has it evolved to today? And what does the future hold for you?
So stuMagz, as a name symbolifies, it started out with a thought called student magazine.
Right.
So very funnily, Google is 6 letters and Facebook is 8.
Yeah.
So I wanted something 7. So, and the moment you buy a domain and stuff,
yeah,
you always want this 6 letter domain or a
7 letter domain.
Nice
and short, yeah.
Nice and short. Yeah. So the initial thought was to create a kind of a discovery platform,
right,
across colleges, so that brands or companies discover students for their outreach.
Right.
And apart from the outreach, they discover a platform to find regular good skilled talent.
Right.
And the whole idea was tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 colleges in India.
Right.
So the reason for tier 1, tier 2, tier 3 colleges in India, they constitute 35,000 colleges out of 38,000 colleges in India.
Wow.
And there are 39,000 colleges in India today.
Right. Right.
And there are close to 10 million students who come out of colleges every year.
Right. And 80% of them are coming out from tier 1, tier 2 and tier 3.
Absolutely.
Right.
And these students, they don't have a representation or they don't have a platform.
Right.
And this is completely disintegrated.
Right.
And today, people say Facebook has connected everyone.
Yeah.
But we don't know most of our college students itself.
True.
So, and most of the talents don't get recognized till the world recognizes them.
Correct.
Not, you know, before the world recognizes, there is no platform inside
true
a college
true
which recognizes them. For brands too, today to identify or having a low-cost customer acquisition channel, there is no platform at all. And they see the students as great customers or consumers or influencers for their brands.
Correct.
Because majority of the Gen Z, the Generation Z,
are influenced by the Gen Z.
Yes. So a parent wants to buy a mobile phone, is asking his son,
yeah,
who is a college-going student, what brand should I buy, yeah, or can you buy one for me?
True, true, true.
So the decision maker is a person who is in the college.
Yeah.
A girl student decides which washing machine,
yeah,
or a guy, son, decides which front door washing machine to be bought by a mother.
Correct.
So these are the different perspective from a brand.
Yeah.
And colleges have lots of talents which are captives.
Sure.
And these captives are not targeted in a direct manner,
mm,
in an online and an offline manner.
Mm.
So this was the first basic thought.
Sure.
Then we evolved from a magazine. We added event ticketing,
sure,
to the platform because there are lots of events.
College events that happen.
Right. So these are the low-hanging fruits.
Yeah.
And these events are great places to promote brands and companies too.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
the ticketing was a DIY tool which we added.
Correct.
Thanks to demonetization, because most of the college events were cash-run events.
Correct. Correct.
And big event ticketing players, for them, those percentages don't work out because of low ticket sizes.
Correct. Correct.
Because $100, $150 is the cost of the ticket.
Yeah.
Right. So the bigger players don't see a great attraction,
yeah,
here. For us, it's more about the data.
Right.
It's more about the engagement.
Yeah.
So then we added opportunities. We added quiz.
Right.
Daily live quiz at 7 o'clock.
Right.
So daily, because now currently we are working with 20 plus brands.
Okay.
For their brand coupons, which create more walk-ins to the stores.
Sure.
Which creates more opportunities. So we are working with different, we are not working with many brands. We are working with lots of agencies.
Right.
And unfortunately, I worked with PAD and on different assignments too. So how we are looking at it is like a low cost customer acquisition channel.
Interesting.
Which is focused at Gen Z.
Right, right. So you give your brands a very niche audience. You give your brands a very,
right,
you know, a very real audience, you know, right, which coming from tier 2, tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. I think markets there are exploding. All the FMCG brands for decades have had, you know, a good stronghold from that market. But now I think it's only growing with, right, the disposable income, etc. But yeah, I mean, it's a very fresh sort of a platform, right? And nothing like this exists in India?
So there are platforms which are scattered.
Okay.
Which is, there's no integrated platform,
okay,
as such.
Okay.
So there are a couple of platforms which do market surveys.
Right.
There are platforms which have content marketing.
Right.
There are platforms for internships. for campus ambassador hiring and stuff.
Like intern
shala. Intern shalas or fraps and different platforms are there.
So stuMagz aspires to be the one consolidated platform for anything to do with students.
Anything to do with students. That's the reason we keep calling things student things stuMagz, which is a cliche term these
days. Correct.
But the whole idea, because most of the students here, when you have a platform, all the platforms are pull platforms. So the point is, a student should come to the platform.
Correct.
We are a push platform.
Correct.
So because the whole world is moving towards push now.
Yeah.
No one wants him to come.
Yeah.
So let's say we are watching this. We keep asking, please subscribe our channel.
Correct. Correct.
Because we say, once we upload this video, we want to push this video to his mobile.
Correct.
Because we don't expect him to remember about Padcast will release a video on so and so day.
Correct.
He won't come to a
channel. We need him to push it and we need to endorse
Correct.
It to another like-minded person, etc.
Right. That's the reason I'm giving this analogy here. To youth, you can't expect a youth to come to a brand.
Correct.
And the loyalty of this youth is very less.
Yeah.
Today, the loyalty of the brand loyalty in the today's Gen Z is very, very less.
And also most FMCG brands and large-scale retail entertainment fashion brands, they all build their business model around loyalty.
Correct.
So they believe that you get them in first, get them to like and taste, you know, sort of experience us. And then over time, you know, by them becoming loyalists, we'll sort of make profits.
Correct.
Right. But that's at stake with today's Gen Z, because they don't really accept anything as, you know, a forever thing. So
because it's psychologically thing. You know, we come from joint families in the past.
Yeah.
Now nuclear families. Yeah. Now these days family, it's becoming obsolete.
Correct.
In the Gen Z.
Correct.
So now you can understand it's a psychological behavior.
Correct.
And it can be connected to the brand too. Like, because now brands need to understand that there should be a continuous engagement for people.
Yeah.
Now we are working with a brand. I cannot name a brand as such, but you know, there are different brands. One of the brands which we are doing, like every week, we are doing one quiz with the students.
Sure.
And giving away coupons.
Sure.
Giving away gifts.
Sure.
So these online activities, sometimes we do BTL activities in the college.
In the colleges itself,
So that's keeping them engaged so that the eyeballs are on the brand regularly.
Yeah.
And you keep having a brand recall.
Correct.
Every now and then. Because the attention span is 8 seconds today.
Correct.
Tomorrow that attention span may
might
go
drop even further.
Drop even further.
Yeah. Before we get to how you sort of, I know that you do this thing, a drive around acquisition drive with a gamified process and all of that. Before we get to discussing that, I just want to ask you one thing. How do you exercise responsibility when you're dealing with that audience of a 17 to 25 or, you know, even younger kind of an age group? Because since you consolidate them and you hold access to them, you're the gatekeeper. A lot of brands want to leverage for different reasons. You know, how do you know when to expose the students, when not to expose the students? Well, it comes with a responsibility because very, very influenceable age.
So the reason you have asked a very sensible question as the responsibility, generally we sign non-disclosure with the colleges too.
Right.
So we ensure that this complete platform is not an open platform.
Yeah.
It's a curated platform.
Right.
So any content or quiz or an event should go through an approval layer, which goes through the central office itself.
Sure.
So it cannot get directly published onto the platform.
Right.
The second thing, which because this ensures the right content is reaching out to people, so that it doesn't become a confessions page.
Yeah, yeah.
The second,
also you don't want fake news traveling. You don't want the wrong influences on.
Right. Yeah. And the second thing which we start our exercise doing is we try to keep away from few gray areas. We try to understand that these are the brands which we cannot work.
Sure.
You know, we have our own due diligence when we work with brands or companies, the kind of offers or whatever it is.
So you pick and choose based on the what you think works for students, what shouldn't be even presented to students.
Correct.
Right.
So there are a few regulations kind of a thing, that you cannot go with alcohols based brands.
Yeah.
There are a few.
Those are outright against the law.
Against the law
of the land.
Right. And there are other things like, you know, I'll give an example. There was kind of someone who came up with like a job fair.
Hmm.
So please promote a job fair on your platform.
Yeah.
So then the whole legit question which I ask is like, I need letters from HRs of those companies.
Yeah.
Because without you are which, authorized to do a job fair.
Yeah. Without which neither do you want to lose the
credibility
of your organization, nor do you want to mislead students
absolutely
to a wrong place where they might get siphoned off some money.
So we ensure that these things happen in a very particular processed manner.
Yeah.
So, and we get it proper agreement done with them.
With all the nuances on
the... With the stakeholders.
Yeah.
So the reason why I gave that example is like most of the times, any medium which becomes a trusted medium needs to be more responsible.
Yeah, I think the responsibility only keeps growing.
Right. And the kind of audience, currently we are with 350K, that is like 3.5 lakh students now.
Yeah.
And it is growing on close to 40 to 50,000 a month.
Congratulations, that's huge.
So, and this kind of audience, currently we are more or less in southern part of India.
Correct.
So now we are going to the northern India, but the recent travels to different parts of India, I understood one point, a student psyche is same.
Yeah.
Wherever you go, a student thinks in a similar fashion.
Context is slightly different, but absolutely, psyche is the same.
The psyche is same. Mm. And the kind of the behavioral patterns or the purchasing part. Mm. Because today I see there is a big question mark because you spoke about responsibility and purchasing power from a brand point of view.
Yeah.
If we combine, the kind of highest response campaigns on our platform are the platforms which have social responsibility.
Correct.
So, because we try to take the right news.
Right.
Let's say we work on traffic awareness.
Right.
So, we worked with the traffic police on that. When we had awareness drive, we had a competition on the platform for the poster presentation.
Right.
And innovatively, we gave gifts as helmets.
Right.
To the students.
Very
with
nice.
Co-branded helmets. So, that helped us to take the branding to the next level.
Right.
Second thing, which we created a BTL activity in every parking lot in a college.
Okay.
Because the highest amount of accidents happen are the college going students.
Right.
So when we started doing these activities, the responsibility of us is growing day by day.
Correct.
To take the right news.
Right. So could you tell us a little more about this customer acquisition drive, you know, which when you say customer, you mean largely students, right?
Right.
Through some gamified mechanisms that you've developed. Because two aspects where I think there's a little bit of technology which contributes to your business. One, what you said a little while earlier about how you present data to brands, right? So there must be some technology that you deploy, you know, and sort of build and improve over time. And second aspect is this thing about how you actually reached 3.5 lakh students on the platform. So how does that work and what kind of gamification do you use?
So there are two things here. One from a brand perspective, one from a college user acquisition perspective, stuMagz.
Sure.
So from a brand perspective, it's all about creating a bespoke plan, understanding the purpose of the brand.
Right.
So when we understand the purpose behind it, it's almost like, you know, we have to work in tandem with them.
Correct.
Because one size doesn't fit all.
Right.
Sometimes a brand is visible, already a well-known brand. The strategy might be different to take it out to the students in a gamified way. So I'll give you one example. There was a commute brand where we worked with a leaderboard concept.
Okay.
Where we created a coupon kind of a structure for every student who applies for it.
Right.
And the moment they apply for it for an internship, rather than directly sitting for an interview, we gave them a coupon of that app.
Okay.
They have to get as much business so that there is a leaderboard. So that the moment they get more number of commute rides for that application, their number goes up in the leaderboard.
Right.
So that's the automatic qualification rather than an aptitude test to get hired for a brand.
Correct.
So
you link it to career opportunities, you link it to credibility of the student in terms of what they can pull off,
right,
you know, their skill sets and their...
And kind of a free time opportunity for them.
Right.
So when you have a feet on the... feet soldiers for different things, like a freelance guys.
Correct.
Lots of students have ample amount of
time.
To make some extra revenue.
Yeah.
So for brands, it's a great asset because they are getting the ground opinion.
Yeah.
One. And sometimes these surveys play a very big role in understanding the user behavior.
Also, the value for money, deploying a middle-aged resource versus a student.
Correct.
They get a lot more value for money because they can track a larger area.
Right.
You know, conducting research. They can
and
even,
they're not permanent too.
Yeah, yeah.
So again, you always have a
plug and play. Plug and play.
Plug and play, and you can get things done at a very faster pace.
Right.
So from a college's point of view,
right.
So most of the students need those internships in brands.
Right.
And most of the colleges want to keep their students busy with activities.
True.
Because these are the exposures which are more valuable than those theoretical trainings which happen.
Correct.
So let's say a customer acquisition drive of a fintech brand.
Yeah.
So which has to set up merchant acquisition.
Correct.
So you see those digital payments
kiosks.
Most of the things, we worked with multiple brands in that area.
Sure.
So where we set up, students will onboard a merchant into as a digital digital payment accepted vendor.
Right.
So this is done by students, so that you see now a Panipuri wala is also accepting digital payments.
Correct.
So these are the works which are done by students in their free time.
Yeah.
So when we start giving such activities, most of the students would love to be part of such platforms.
True.
Because they keep on getting opportunities again and again.
True.
So it's like a very simple thing where most of the colleges are being part of us, because when we go to brands, we are representing lots of colleges at once.
True.
A brand cannot keep talking to each college.
Correct.
So some of the colleges said, we'll directly go and talk to brands. I said, please go ahead. But the whole idea is a brand cannot give time to every college.
Every college. They'd rather work with a platform, right, and some data.
And the other thing, what happens is a credibility factor, as we discussed earlier.
Correct.
Too. So how you segregate those data? How you understand, like, you know, we are also evolving as a platform.
Correct.
So some a platform like Facebook took 6 to 7 years after their launch to launch a brand portal.
Right.
A DIY portal.
Correct.
Initially, they didn't have a DIY portal too.
Right.
You need to approach Facebook for a blog or an ad or something like that. So we are a 3.5-year-old organization.
Correct.
So we are evolving on how to analyze our data.
And so how you can open up self-serve mechanisms. And
correct. Yeah. So we want to, by next Jan, we are planning to launch a stuMagz biz kind of a thing.
Okay.
So where you can target first year students, second year students,
okay,
or third year students, or geography again.
You can filter to a great extent.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we have wanted to, again, in the platform evolvement to attract more users. Mm. So we are coming up with new features. So we are coming up with a feature with coins kind of a structure.
Mm.
So that will be launched eventually in the month of December.
Okay.
So where you can start paying for brands which work with us. Let's say any consumer brand. If you buy something on a platform.
Sure.
You get equal amount of number of coins.
Right.
So how the different applications like Cred has shown the road about credit card payment.
Sure.
So we wanted to come up with student brands where they can purchase and get some coins.
Right.
And these coins can be used again in different places.
Very nice.
Where they can spend those coins in different other brands as currency.
Right.
So this is one thing which we are launching soon.
Right.
So these are the things which keep us on our toes. And from a point like these concepts are like, you know, we need to evolve and innovate on a day-to-day basis.
Sure.
Because this Gen Z always wants to see something new.
New, yeah. So what do you think is the future of stuMagz and where is it going?
So, fingers crossed again, you know, we want to be a globally recognized digital campus ecosystem.
Right.
Because
right.
We see this Gen Z as like, you know, 50%+ of the population.
Correct.
And the lifetime value of the customer is very high.
Yeah. Once acquired, you can journey with that customer for a while.
So the customer acquisition cost is same as you acquire some other customer too.
Yeah.
So I keep telling lots of now, the way forward, we are looking to partner with more agencies and more getting in them to reach more brands. And these brands should understand we be a funnel to reach out to colleges, because we have established this pipeline.
Yeah.
And I always say the difference between a product and services.
Yeah.
The product is one-time investment.
Yeah.
And this product is like a pipeline across colleges.
Correct.
And the moment you do that, the amount of revenue you can generate from different brands using the same pipeline
is
high.
Correct.
So our future plan is to reach out. The current goal, the next immediate goal, is to reach a 1 million student platform.
Right.
And in future, because every year there are at least 1 to 5 million students coming into colleges.
Right.
So the rejuvenation of the platform happens at every year.
Churn happens every year.
Right.
So there are also some other challenges, right? One of the challenges is the life stages that are much quicker in your ecosystem. So how do you retain people that have gotten out of college?
Right.
What do they have to gain from staying connected with stuMagz? Right. These are also some questions that need to be answered.
So these are the challenges. See, any platform has this challenge.
Yeah.
Today, if you see from a point of our platform, the life cycle is 4 years.
Yeah. What after 4 years?
What after 4 years? So we started alum networks for colleges.
Right.
So, but alum networks are not that active unless they have some benefit for them.
Correct.
So what we are trying to do in the coming time, because we are just a 3.5-year-old firm.
Yeah.
So in our future course, we have plans of, like, let's say someone working in pad now. He's connected from a college.
Correct.
So most of them see there is an opportunity in pad, but he doesn't know where to share that opportunity except his social channels. So, but he gets a referral income out of that.
True.
So that referral income is kind of a motivation to stay with the college because it's always a captive audience.
Correct.
For right resources for his future income.
So rate the following in terms of educational impact to the education industry. Unacademy, Byju's, Coursera, Khan Academy, and why?
Unacademy, Byju's,
Coursera, and Khan Academy.
Khan Academy.
And why?
Okay. So Byju's. You want to rate it the order or every individual separately? Yes.
No, rate. How would you see their contribution to
contribution,
the education
sphere? Okay. Yeah. So I see because they all come from different segments. It's very tough to rate them in one area. Because if you say K-12 and the higher education segment, correct, they're two different segments.
Test prep is a different segment, K-12 is a different segment.
So let's say Coursera and Unacademy fall in one area.
Right.
Byju's is in every area. And Khan Academy is more concentrated in the schools, in the growing up ages.
Right.
So Khan, I personally feel Khan Academy stands top for me any day. Second comes Byju's, third comes Coursera, and fourth comes Khan Academy.
Right.
So if you see the other
what do you like about Khan Academy's model?
So the Khan Academy, it's more global.
Right.
It's more global and more philanthropic in nature.
So what is an innovation according to you that our education system desperately needs today? In what space?
Digital space.
Okay.
So, you know,
there needs to be more sort of a headway made in the digital space.
Correct. And adapting to the new courses.
Right.
And how we create more, again, we have to, it's not about something new, but we have to go back to the olden days again.
Right.
So it's like, you know, there is something called set win.
Right.
When we were growing up.
Yeah, it's still around.
Yeah. Now I'm saying more active in those days.
Correct.
Now the kind of people, the new age Gen Z might not know what set win.
Correct.
So we used to know about set win buses.
Correct.
Our mobile operation.
And set win was a massive organization.
Even still, till
date.
Continues to be.
Yeah.
But the kind of impact.
Yeah.
So it's like if you go to the Finnish education system, the Finland-based education system where someone is taught something.
Yeah.
So now, I personally feel like now, let's say, now you run PAD.
Yeah.
Now we need to have a course
yeah.
powered by PAD in college.
Yeah.
So that becomes your L&D cell.
Correct.
And you start, that's a factory for you.
Yeah.
For your new pipeline rather than you think about how to hire a new person.
Correct.
The culture of PAD should be taught.
At that level.
And the kind of expectations or the client relations. Yeah. What's the etiquette or what is the way you do.
So you're seeing a digital innovation in a industry campus
collaboration. So the courses should be customized according to the industry.
To the real world. Yeah.
In a way where this is being done by banks heavily now.
Right.
Thanks to Manipal.
Right.
So
right.
Manipal has started courses like PGDM by ICICI.
Oh, very nice.
PGDM by Kotak.
Very nice.
So these courses, 6 months, you pay the institute fee.
Yeah.
And the 6 months, the company pays stipend to this fellow.
Yeah.
The beauty here is.
And then he gets employed by the company.
He gets employed by the same company.
Yeah.
So you can try out the person.
Correct.
From day zero.
Yeah. And then decide whether you want to.
Whether you want to continue him or not.
Yeah.
And the beauty here is he is assured of an employment.
Yeah.
If he performs well.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two. The company is also assured of a pipeline so that he knows what's his forecast.
So
tomorrow you want to start up 6 branches.
He knows exactly when is the fresher outcome.
And when you want to start. And the other biggest thing is like lack of right folks who can fit in your culture.
So these guys get culturally aligned much earlier.
Right.
So traditional classrooms or digital classrooms, where do you think students' attention span will be better?
Attention span is, I always vote for a traditional classroom.
Right. One-on-one
is
personal,
always better. But I personally prefer a combination of both.
Okay. A hybrid kind of a model.
Hybrid kind of model.
What does it take to be a Forbes 30 under 30? What sacrifices did you have to make? And how did that recognition come by? I'm sure it was not easy.
It was tough.
Yeah.
But most of them, but it has its own pros and cons.
Right.
The moment you, before getting into it, you know, the kind of work or you leave a very comfy job.
Correct.
And you get into the entrepreneurship route.
Correct.
That's the toughest part.
Correct.
Like the pros of it is the kind of attention you get or the PR attention.
The PR attention that you get.
The kind of a media recognition.
Yeah.
You know, the kind of maybe Richard Branson recognizing you.
Correct.
Helps you it puts you in a great position.
Yeah.
When an entrepreneur spots you for an article.
Correct.
Or a front page article.
Yeah.
These are all the pros.
So the kind of networking opportunities it provides, the reach it provides is very big.
Very big, and it puts you in a different league altogether.
Yeah.
And it adds more responsibility on your shoulders, the kind of work you should do.
Correct.
Or the work you should do in the coming days too. It has its own advantages and disadvantages too.
So I know that you've ruled out anything to do with engineering, but if you were not an entrepreneur in the education space and the community outreach with student space, you know, what would you be doing, Charan? I'm very curious to know. Was there ever an alternative path?
Very tough to choose. You know, education was a sector which I felt maybe I would have been an evangelist for different brands and being a public speaker, if not a platform. Maybe I was an individual.
Correct.
I always feel individuals never scale.
Yeah.
Organizations scale.
Yeah.
And scale.
No, individuals do scale, but I think after they're out of an organization, they scale much faster. They build a success story, they scale much faster.
It's almost post 40 kind of a thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's like, you know, if you see Guy Kawasaki.
Yeah.
So that's how it works.
You bring all your experiences, good and bad.
Right.
And then you basically are there
to
share.
Then you
write a book. Yeah. Or you catalyze the growth of an organization or two.
So one thing I would have been doing is like maybe one is public speaking is one which is very close to my heart.
Yeah.
How I can be of help to a lot of people.
Yeah.
Or be an adjunct faculty in few universities.
Correct.
So where you teach entrepreneurship or maybe advertising or marketing.
Basically, you bring reality to their doorstep.
Right. Or else I'll be on the other side of the coin and interviewing Gautam too.
Someday soon.
So, yeah.
Look forward to it.
Thank you.
Great fun having you on the show.
Thank you, Gautam.
Thanks a bunch, Charan. So that was Charan. Founder of stuMagz, Forbes 30 Under 30. It was a great pleasure chatting with him. We will have many more riveting conversations here on OCD. Look forward to keeping this going. Bye.